Jesus really shook up the world, didn't he? He was a world shaker. Welcome to the video. The good news that we have is that Jesus is back and bringing a new dispensation. Part of his overall ministry for this world is a new dispensation. And if we think about the first dispensation, we realize just what a world shaker he really is. He comes to shake up the world for sure. He doesn't bring little wimpy dispensations. Absolutely not. So we should realize that we're in for something very big, very big and very major. That will change our perspective of this world forever, just as the first part of his ministry changed the world forever. However you want to view it, there's no question that it did change the world forever, very strongly. So what we're talking about here is this new dispensation, new phase in Jesus's ministry to us, to free us from really our own arrogance. To free us really from our own arrogance, and started that out with his time in Judea, and the ministry there with all the miracles and the parables, and then the crucifixion, the resurrection. This really shook up our psyche very strongly. So he's about ready to shake it up again. So I'm functioning as like a spokesperson for the new dispensation. Spokesperson for the new dispensation, saying it's going to be here very soon, very 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 soon. And exactly what it will be, I don't know yet. Just like John the Baptist didn't know how Jesus's ministry would go, right? Nobody did. We don't know exactly what's going to happen. I'm not privy to that. But I do know that he's here. He's come back to this world, and says, "I'm here. I'm here to relate, and I'm into it. I'm totally into it." So he's into this next phase of his ministry for this world, and he's a world beater. He's a world shaker. It's extraordinary what his ministry is about. So it's going to be something, again, really, really, really big. And that will change, again, our perspective of ourselves, of the world, forever. Fundamentally change it. So I'm looking forward to it. And so I keep on going here. Sometimes I get a little down. It seems like so difficult to make a dent in this world, doesn't it? The way things are going, if you pay any attention at all to the way the world is going, it's very depressing, very depressing. It's a madhouse here. So it's better to pay attention to this new dispensation and prepare yourself for it. Prepare yourself. Now, a new dispensation lifts us out of the old one, so to speak. So there are these steps in Jesus' ministry that are required because our arrogance has so baffled us. We've baffled ourselves so badly. We've scared ourselves. We've intimidated ourselves. We've confused ourselves. And it's a really very difficult to set it down, And so We take a step forward, two steps forward, then one step back. Two steps forward, one step back. This new dispensation, I can say what it is fundamentally about, is we now are going to set down this attempt to integrate arrogance and truth. We're going to finally set that down altogether. This is what it's all about. It's non-dual. It's non-dual realization of the oneness. And exactly how that plays out, and I don't know. If there's some surprises, I don't know. Maybe. Jesus was full of surprises in his ministry in Judea, full of surprises. He never knew what he's going to do next. So this is what we have on tap now. And once again, we have been still trying. The reason why we're still in this situation, we still trapped, what we feel trapped, this feeling of stuckness, trappedness, and things aren't quite the way we want them to be, is because we've been trying to integrate truth and lies, integrate truth and lies. In order to do this, our arrogance has believed that, split itself. It believes that there's good and bad arrogance, or that there's two sides to arrogance that need to be integrated. So we've gone through different phases. First we say, well, one side's bad and one side's good, and the good has to defeat the bad. And then we say, well, there are two sides and they're both good, but they're different, really, really different, and we have to integrate the difference. And so we've been stuck in this attempt to integrate. This is where we're stuck. And this is the big step, is to recognize that you don't integrate truth and lies at all. Truth is true, and lies are never true. And so this is the new dispensation that Jesus is bringing to lift, to get us to accept this fundamental, all-important truth, and finally finish what we started, and trying to be liberated from the bondage of our own arrogance. So we're well prepared for this. That's for sure. He's prepped us already with A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, The Other Voice. These are some of the help. There's some of the prep that we've had available, so we can prepare for something that is really gives us the boost that we need to finally stop these games that we're playing in our mind. We've just been playing mind games with arrogance. Arrogance has just been playing games. And so we've reached this point now where we are still playing games, and we now are saying, well, we need to integrate the two aspects of the of arrogance, as if arrogance has different aspects to it, or different good and bad, or, you know, there's some difference. No, it's all the same. It's all nothing. It's all nothing. You don't split nothing in half and then try to integrate it. You know, that's just ridiculous. But that's what we're trying to do. So now we're saying, well, there's not God the Father, you know, there's now God the Father and God the Mother, you know, two aspects. And we need to integrate the two, or they need to be joint gods, you know, dual gods, both God the Father and God the Mother, or God the Father, Mother, or, you know, this is all trying to integrate truth and lies, actually. There's only one God from the very beginning. And it doesn't even have a gender or anything like that, actually. But it's only one. There's not two. There's not two. And our arrogance is trying to make it seem like there are two. And our arrogance also is trying to say, also trying to get one side to win over the other. That's still in play, too. That's very strongly part of our experiencing here, is we have one aspect of arrogance symbolize God, and the other symbolizes the underdog spirit that's weak and an underdog. There's no way that they can ever overcome the other side, which is represents God. It is strong, and this is kind of the yin yang, the male female sort of thing. And how we play out this game is, the purpose of playing this game out is to get a winner where the weak triumphs over the strong. David triumphs over Goliath, so to speak. And then we believe that this is winning, that we finally defeated God, symbolically, that we've proven that that which is subordinate to God can turn the tables and defeat God, because we believe we're in a contest with God. Due to our fact that we wanted to be greater than God. And so we had to make perfection seem like something that's not here right now. So neither us nor God is perfect, but it's something to be attained as a prize, as, you know, winning it, getting there first, like a contest, like a race. Who can get there first, or, you know, who can win a contest? And so we believe we've been in this contest with God. And so to us, God, the prime creator, seems like this all-powerful person, very, you know, stronger than we are, though, a spirit. And so we've played this out here in our imagination, which is very powerful, very creative. And so we have the situation where we set up this dualistic paradigm where the man seems to be, you know, physically strong and forceful and all this, and the woman seems to be subservient. I was going to say subversive, but that too, but subservient. And the play is to seem like the woman, the poor little woman, she cannot, the man is too much. Oh, she just has to, you know, be subversive. Okay. We're playing this out as the role of spirit and God, God and spirit. And what we're doing is we're now having the woman win over the man. And so flipping the tables. And to us, this symbolizes that we, spirit, can defeat this all-powerful God that we thought can never be defeated, that it symbolizes, yes, we can defeat it. This is why people are so sucked in to what is going on in the world. They think it represents victory, a victory, that weakness has triumphed over strength, that the lesser has triumphed over the greater, so to speak. And, of course, the whole thing is we're scripting all this. We're doing it. It's just like a dream that we're scripting. And it's completely manufactured evidence. It has no relevance to God whatsoever. None. Zero. But it's like a symbolic thing. We love like movies and plays and stuff where we... But these people are just actors and actresses acting out scripts. But we take it as if what they're acting out actually happened and represents a real result. But what's happening in this world here, as women essentially are triumphing over men now, and men are ideologically and legally, you know, cowering in fear, thoroughly defeated in spirit. We think that this is somehow represents an actual result, that it's somehow causative and relates to reality. It doesn't relate to the reality at all, the same way a dream doesn't relate to reality, or a movie or a play or something, which is all intentionally scripted with everybody acting out these roles. So, you know, this is what's happening. So all of this play of arrogance, it can be brought to light, and we can recognize what's taking place in this world. Is our attempt to win perfection and gain perfection, and God to lose out on perfection, so that way we can claim we're greater than God. Because if we, this is the only way that we can play out our desire to be greater than God, because God is perfection right now. So we have to say, no, perfection exists, but it's not right now. It's something in the future. And we're racing, see who gets there first, so to speak. And so we play out this drama, and it's just been an astonishing turnaround if you live through it the last 50, 60 years. And viewing all this, for me, I was aware that it's just all scripted. All this is scripted. It's like a play. It's like a play. And nobody gives genuine thought to it, just like actresses and actors don't give genuine thought. They just keep acting according to the script. This is what's been going on. I look at everything. I say, why don't we all just stop and say, now, wait a minute. Let's take a look at this carefully. And nobody does that. Almost nobody does that. Because they are acting out a script. Bodies are just symbols, stick figures, really. And these stick figures are acting out a script from mind, which is designed to symbolically prove that the lesser can defeat the greater, and somehow make believe that this means that we have therefore attained perfection, that we have now won, defeated God, and that we are the ones that are perfect, and God is not perfect, so God ceases to exist, really, in the eyes of perfection. Imperfection doesn't exist. This is how we're trying to do it. So many are going along with this because they think that somehow this symbolic, completely manufactured play that we're engaged in is going to somehow result in their happiness and perfection, where the fact is it doesn't do anything at all. It doesn't do anything at all. And so there is no real dialogue taking place in the world that I notice. I've always been willing for real dialogue here. So let's just sit down and let's see if we can look together, look into what's going, what is this world about? Almost nobody is interested in doing that at all, because they're still caught up in arrogance and believing that they have to win, because if they don't win, they feel they'll be annihilated. So they feel they have to win. So therefore, they're simply following a script that the logic of arrogance is presenting. It's as if we have this advisor that is telling us what to do, and then we do it. But this advisor is really just the inexorable logic of our own arrogance. There's an inexorable logic that arises from it, out of necessity, and we end up just following that script as if we have no choice in the matter, as if this was God scripting our lives, when in fact it's not God scripting our lives. Believe it or not, our lives are not really scripted. Life is not really a script that God is writing for us. God does not have a script for us that we must obey and follow. God is not like it. God is just pure freedom, and we're free to write our own scripts and own creativity, and we're never held to anything at all. So it's not like God is this producer and designer and scripter that has this script and says, this is your part, this is your part, you have to play your part, this part, you have to play this part. That doesn't exist in reality in any way. The scripting is being done by the logic of arrogant deviation. This is what we're feeling. And very few challenge this script. But clearly, you can see, for me, everything that happens, I say, no, wait a minute. That doesn't have to happen that way. It just a word would change it. Just say, no, wait a minute. But everybody is going around like zombies, like actresses and actors, because bodies are just automatons, essentially. They're not self-directed at all. And so it's our mind that is listening to the logic of arrogance that is then scripting out everything that's happening. So bodies just act and do things this and do this like that, just like they're puppets, just like they're puppets. So I say to the mind, hey, wait a minute, mind. Slow down on this puppeteering for a second here. You know. And this is the why when you have intelligence, you look at the world, you say, this is an insane asylum. All the stuff that keeps taking place here, you know, the news is just full of it. I say, why does any of that, even one single instance, why does that have to take place? Easily could have been avoided and not take place. So it's a rather scary thing to realize that this whole world is just like scripted, and there's no real reason taking place at all here. You know, that's just like me to say, wow. But even more scary is your realization that if you don't liberate yourself from this play of arrogance, you're going to continue on in this script. And that's even more scary. And so we really ask Jesus and all those who have been liberated from this script, from arrogance, to help us out. So we're right at the point where this new dispensation is going to really lift off. And so people are, I feel that people are pretty scared, pretty jittery, saying, uh-oh, you know, what's going to happen? I'm not too worried about it. I don't really engage in worrying about it, because I just feel like, you know, as long as we keep our spiritual practice going, we'll be fine. Full stop in the wow. Whatever happens, if it's really wowish, we'll just say, okay, full stop in the wow. And we can do it, no matter what. So that, I believe this carries the day. Your discipline and spiritual practice, your discipline carries the day, or you enables you to go forward. There's a man that I know who has been sick in bed and he can't breathe, couldn't breathe. There's a hospital emergency. It's real terrible. A lot of people thought he might not make it. You know, that they may not come back. And I was just thinking of him today. And I just thought, I was thinking like, you know what? I want to congratulate him. I was thinking about how to welcome him back. I said, why am I thinking this? That's odd, but I kind of had an idea of how to welcome him back. And then I went into a place, store, and there he was. And I was like, wow. So somehow I was aware that he was back. And he says, well, I'm breathing one breath at a time, one breath at a time. And so we have been through a situation in the last 60 years on this planet where we may feel that we can hardly breathe. We've gotten to that point where it's extremely difficult to breathe spiritually here. And yet, you know what? We're still breathing. We're still breathing. And we may actually make a tremendous recovery and be breathing very well sooner than we think. One thing that can make a big difference is if we recognize there was an alternative to this world, you know, a much better alternative, then I feel that would like take a great load off our mind, right? Because the idea of continuing on with this world in the future is so horrendous that it's enough to, you know, make you die, but you can't die because then you'll just be reborn here. You know, it's like a catch-22. And so if we could realize, hey, there is a better place, there is a better life, there is a, you know, matter what, whatever it is, that would be very helpful. Now, the play of arrogance has gotten very boring, and it's lost its juice. It really has lost its juice. And what happens when that, you know, what happens, and then you just feel like this world, whoa, you know, what good is it actually? Why should I go anywhere? Why should I do anything? What good is this world? It's lost its juice. Because you realize it's all scripted, it's all a game, it's all a play of arrogance, and what point? There's no point to it at all. There's no value to it whatsoever. It's just trying to generate a winner. You know, we want to generate winning. That's all we're trying to generate, winning. By all sorts of ridiculous, crazy, stupid means. None of it has any meaning whatsoever. And eventually you see that, and it loses its salt, you know. It's like putting salt on your food and the salt has no taste to it. No matter how much salt you pour on it, there's still no taste. It doesn't do any good anymore. So the world is, you know, loses its flavor. Because before, at least we thought there was a chance of winning. So that enabled us to project this hope onto the world and sort of chase after it, like chasing after a rainbow. You know, if you think you're going to catch the rainbow, you know, you're going to feel like we're all excited and happy and like, wow, you know, we're chasing it, we're going to get it. And you feel, but when you finally realize you can never catch the rainbow, then what do you do? I mean, wow. It's a whole different game, isn't it, at that point? So I've certainly reach that point, and others have too, that you realize that there's no catching of the rainbow. There's no winning at all. There's no winning here or anywhere. There's no losing. Winning or losing don't exist. There's nothing to value here. So it's a challenge to continue on, but what we do is we continue on by driven by the fact that we don't want to continue, find ourselves back here again, get a return ticket here. We don't want to leave with a return ticket here, that's for sure. And we want to be 100% sure of that, not 99.9%, 100% sure of this. So we spend our time focusing on getting ready for this new dispensation. Now, is Jesus the only one working on this new dispensation? No, I don't think so. I think there are probably a lot that are working, helping out with this new dispensation. It's a very big, big deal. And just in time. I mean, just in time right now, right? As I said, May is going to be an absolute meltdown, and it has been. We're in a free fall, actually, is what's happening. Free fall mode in this world. the play here, the play here is has just turned, has given up any effort to even appear to be anything other than an absolute farce. See, before, it seemed like, well, maybe, it's kind of like if you watch a really farcical, some sort of farcical movie that is just, you know, stuff starts happening, more and more starts happening, and then at some point, you get this feeling like it's completely out of control, and there's no way that any order is going to be established. I mean, this is just, you know, beyond figure, you know, putting it back together again. The farce just goes completely haywire, and that's where we're at right now. There's not even any pretense any longer that it's not a farce. You know, the actors and actresses are just acting out this, you know, lunacy here. In a vain attempt to come up with a winner. And say, we're winning. This is winning. This is winning. And we're so desperate. We'll throw anything up against the wall. And say, this is winning. This is winning. This is winning. And we're constantly trying as much as we can to come up and believe that we're winning, defeating God, and therefore reaching the goal of perfection, and God, before God reaches the goal of perfection. And so we're the prime creator. So the whole notion that of reaching something is at the heart of our delusion. I've said this many times before. You can't reach enlightenment. Enlightenment is setting down the whole effort of reaching anything. The search, as some have said, the race. Set down the race. We're racing. We're trying to like on a sprint. Try to reach perfection before God reaches perfection. Set down the race, set down the notion of reaching anything, of reaching a state. And only then do we realize what we've always been. So it's extremely paradoxical, and we're not prepared. In some instances, when we actually do for a moment take a break from the race, and then we have this epiphany of realization of what we are, and then we'll say, oh my gosh, I don't want to lose out on that. I better get back into the race as fast as I can. I mean, I must be almost there. So I got to make more efforts to get there. And as I've said, this is the path of no path. This is the race of no race that we're engaged in. And so the mistake that we've been making is when we get that glimpse of our true nature, that we misinterpret that, thinking like, I must be really close, so I need to go even faster in this race, and I'm almost won. I've almost won. I just got to make tremendous efforts to win. And because we believe this, it takes tremendous efforts to free ourselves from this delusion. We're so into the belief that winning is essential, and we've almost won. You say, we're almost there. I even got a glimpse of the finish line. See, there is no finish line. There is no race at all. And this is enlightenment. When we realize this and abide in this, we're enlightened. And theoretically, we can do it any moment whatsoever. Theoretically, we can. It's true right now. Just set the race down. There is no race. But don't struggle trying to set it down, because that in itself it feels like we're trying to win. Say, well, I gotta set it down fast in order to win. We just have to keep hearing this, and it will click. Eventually, we'll get it. So we say, oh, really close. Don't run. See, this is full stop in the wow. This is the path of no path. When we get this glimpse, instead of saying, oh my gosh, look how close it is, I got to make a mad dash for the finish line, say, no, okay. Full stop. Instead of running, just stop. You're not running anywhere. Just sit down. Neither running forward nor backwards. So this is the discipline we need to ultimately just realize that there is no finish line. And there is no race. We're not engaged in a race with God. See, we think we're in a race with God, so how can we realize God? Because we think if we turn to realize God, God will pass us by. So we try to refuse to realize God. We think that means we're ahead of God. And if we think we see God, we say, oh my gosh, God has caught even with me. He's about to pass me. But God is not engaged in any race at all. So when we realize God, there's just this absolute peacefulness of no race at all. No finish line, no goal to reach, no race taking place, no contest, all of that. And this is the new dispensation, at least part of it. This is the goal. And we're not trying to integrate anything. We're not trying to integrate our arrogance with the truth. We're not trying to integrate lies with the truth. We're not trying to say, well, maybe God and we can reach the finish line at the same time. You see, that would be trying to integrate lies and truth. There's no finish line. There's no race. So we cannot make illusions true and then dispel them. See, this is what Jesus teaches in A Course in Miracles. We cannot make illusions true and then dispel those illusions. This is the false way that has been tripping us up. This is what we have to get past. This is the new dispensation, where we recognize that all illusions are untrue, and we set them down. We don't try to make them true and then dispel them. So this practice of full stop in the wow is extremely important. I've even had instances of glimpsing non-dual truth, and I intentionally stopped. I said, okay, let me just stop right here and right now and just sit here and don't do anything about it one way or the other. So I preempted the reaction. Full stop in the wow preempts reactions, we realize, and prevents them from taking place, because when we get a full glimpse of non-dual reality, we think, oh, this is great, oh, this is great. And then suddenly in our mind says, wait a minute, maybe God's caught up with me. Or, wait a minute, I'm so close, I'm almost there. And then immediately that throws us into dualistic arrogant belief, logic of arrogance. And then we can be severely pulled along by that and get into all sorts of stuff, desperately trying to finish. Whereas if we say, okay, but I see that. Okay, now full stop in the wow. I'm just gonna sit down, not try to go forward at all or do anything about it, and just let it sink in. Then we preempt that reactivity, which would sweep us away and waste enormous amount of time for us. Now, of course, this is difficult because everyone still thinks that they need to win. So they think, well, I've almost won. I'm almost there. There is no there to get to. There isn't any there to get to. So we have to practice that when we get a glimpse and we get this flip the script enough to get this feeling like, wow, I see, I'm glimpsing truth, I get a feel of it. Full stop in the wow. Preempt your reactions to that. And the reactions creep up on you too. So through long experience, I've found this out and been able to agree to this practice that the Holy Spirit gave me. Because the reactions are very stealthy and they don't come on you all at once. And yet I've learned for sure that they do come. So instead of waiting for them, which they're too stealthy for that, they'll have you in their grip without you even knowing it, basically. It's just insidious, very insidious. So you intentionally, when you get this wow reaction of elation and a little bit of trepidation, you say, oh my gosh, I know I'm free. I mean, I'm going to be free of my delusion. Then a full stop in the wow. Say, I'm not going to do anything about it. I'm just going to go right into neutral gear and just sit here, doing nothing, thinking nothing, neutral. Now, this is a radical step to take, and it took me maybe about 37 years before I was willing to do this, actually. To do it very consciously. I was struggling to do it all along, but the reactions we have are so insidious, it's hard to trace it back. We say, well, why did that happen? Why do I feel this way? And it's very difficult to directly trace it back to the insight that you had. But it does come from there. It comes from a continuity fear, from the breakthrough. When you have a breakthrough, there you're going to get backlash, and the backlash comes upon you, extremely insidiously. So if you don't take refuge in the full stop and the wowness, full stop and the wow, you are going, that backlash is going to hit you. And then you'll say, woe is me. Why is this happening? I can't believe it. Maybe I was wrong. It can be devastating. I mean, I was 37 years, I was devastated. Having so many breakthroughs and then paying a severe price for it. And not understanding, because you can't, it's hard to trace where what happens afterwards. It's just so insidious. But it is our deep-seated fears that creep up upon us, and gradually we fall under their spell. Okay, so instead of allowing that, you just say no. No to progress, no to fear. Okay, neither one. I'm neutral right now. I am in a neutral condition. I'm not saying yes or no to anything. This is called full stop on the wow. And by doing that, you preempt this insidious backlash of fear. You preempt it. And it saves enormous time. And this is the secret to going very fast on the path. The path of no path. So I cannot reinforce this enough, that if you actually start trying it, you will intuitively realize this makes a huge difference, because you realize, hey, wait a minute. I'm able to keep going along and keep making breakthroughs every day, every day, every day, and I'm not suffering this nervous breakdown, slowdown, all this backlash. It's just not happening to me. What's going on? It's to be exactly because you're practicing full stop in the wild. That's why it's taking place. And so I can compare my path of no path previously and my path of no path now, after I started practicing full stop in the wow. It's like night and day. It's like night and day. Now I don't go into many slumps at all. I go into occasional slumps, but as soon as I say, hey, let's get back into full stop in the wow mode, it dissipates and vanishes. Dissipates and vanishes. So, the good news is there is this technique of practice that works tremendously effective. The bad news is, of course, that our arrogance has a hard time. We have a hard time getting past our arrogance on this and actually practicing it, because we keep thinking, well, if there's some cause, I should be able to locate it. I'm smart enough to be able to put it, my. Trace it back, and how come I'm not able to do that? And we just refuse to do it. We refuse to do it. Because it's almost counterintuitive, because we feel like, wow, I'm so close to winning. Why should I stop now? Because winning is the delusion. That's why. Winning is the delusion. And then we think, whoa, if I'm just not sitting here not trying to win, God's going to win. I'm going to be annihilated. Well, winning is the delusion, even from God's side. God's not trying to win. God's not in any race with us. It's all been a figment of our imagination, actually. So the real practice, as I call it, the new relationship, is encouraging one another to practice full stop in the wowness. This is the new relationship we have with one another. Because ultimately, our true relationship is spirit, formless. A relationship of pure freedom that we all share as one spirit. And in order to relate this way, we have to free ourselves from our arrogance. The arrogance that believes that we can simply say that we're in a race with God, and then God is bound by what we say, that God has to be in a race with that. That's arrogance. The idea we can just say that reality isn't perfect yet, and it's in the future, and we have to, and whoever reaches it first gets it. That's pure arrogance. We cannot change reality in the slightest bit, and any attempt to do so is nothing but sheer arrogance. So we all have this trouble of arrogance, and this full stop in the wow, I have seen through a long lifetime of spiritual practice, intense spiritual practice and suffering, and tremendous difficulty and suffering, I see that this is the best practice that one could really do, that it absolutely prevents the backlash. It minimizes, let's put it that way, it tremendously minimizes it. And prevents those highs and lows, highs and lows, highs and lows, that awful path of highs and lows that just devastate us, right? Just devastate us. We can all get breakthroughs, but then the backlash is just horrible. A lot of us decide, hey, I can't take this anymore. And they give up trying. They don't even want a breakthrough anymore. The price they pay is so severe. So I have just continued every single day of my life trying to make breakthroughs and then trying to minimize the backlash, and most of the time just struggling horribly. And I realize, oh, here it comes again. You know, it's coming upon me, and it's just like, oh, it's just the worst thing. This is terrible. And just every day I'd try it again and try it again and try it again. And finally, I asked the Holy Spirit, you know, what do you suggest? And the Holy Spirit suggested practice this full stop in the wow. And practice the already practice too. Now when I say Jesus is already here, I'm not practicing the already practice. I'm saying this factually. It's not like I'm trying to prepare for him being here. He is already here. And having practiced this full stop in the wowness, I'm able to handle this fact. I'm able to realize this is true, which is a tremendous wow, right? And then just full stop in the wow, okay? Don't do anything about it. Don't go forward with this. Don't retreat from it. Don't think about it. No yes and no no. No yes to it, no no to it. Just neutral. Just go right into this neutral state. Humble, meek, unassuming, neutral state. No yes, no no. So on one hand, I'm saying Jesus is back, and then I go into the wow mode, and I'm not saying anything at all. It's neutral. Neutral mode. Go into neutral. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. Go into neutral and just the wow. Just let it reverberate. Just let it reverberate. So this is how we can handle even this extraordinarily good news, stunningly great news. That's why I'm able to be aware of this and share it with everyone, is because of the full stop on the wow practice. Otherwise, there's no way I could do it. And even with the full stop on the wow practice, it's a little difficult. I sort of felt a little bit down and a little bit irritated today, this afternoon, a little bit irritated. But I said, no, let's get this under control. Let's go back into the discipline, full stop on the wow, and smooth it out. And it's smoothed out already. So we have the powerful tools we need. It's like we have this pile of lumber, and guess what? We have this great chop saw, and just chop through it in about a half an hour. The whole pile of lumber is cut just like that. You know, we have the power tools to do it now. Whereas if you thought you had to use a handsaw to cut through all that, you know, or even a skill saw, it's like, oh my gosh, that's too much work. But you got this real powerful chop saw, and you just go through like butter, like paper, just poop, 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 no problem. So we have the powerful tools now. Just a matter of using them. So the new relationship that I've been talking about is allowing one another this quiet, this full stop in the wow, this neutral mind mode, allowing the neutral mind mode in others and encouraging it actually, and relating to others as either we're relating it in a way as flipping the script with one another, our dialogue, what we're doing is working on flipping the script, or making assertions, helping each other make assertions, or we are in full stop in the wow mode. This is the new relationship. So we're relating to one another in a meditational, spiritual practice way, actually. This is the new relationship. In the new dispensation, we have a new relationship with one another, and that is to allow one another to be in one of these three modes. Right now, nobody's doing that. It's, you know, but we're still in just this old dispensation mode. We're stuck in the mud, actually. Stuck in the mud. We really are stuck in the mud. But we need not be stuck in the mud. So this morning I was doing powerful, powerful assertions. The light of God is shining as me. First I said, the light of God is shining in me. And then I said, the light of God is shining as me. And then I said, the light of God is shining, the shining light of God is me. It is me. The light of God is shining as me. So in other words, the light is me. So the light of God is shining in me now, right now. I said right here, right now, the light of God is shining as me. So this is an assertion. Right here, right now, the light is shining as me. So imagine if we could go up to someone and say, hey, instead of saying, hey, what's happening, you know, and blah, 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 we say, hey, the light of God is shining as me, and they return and say, yeah, I like that one. The light of God is shining as me. Or you may say another one. They say, until you find one both of you agree on and say, let's both say it. Let's say it. The light of God is shining as me. And they say it back. The light of God is shining as me. And then you say it back to them. And see, there's a relationship as assertions like that. And then you'll have a time where you're just quiet. You allow each other to be quiet. You'll say, what are you thinking about? No, you're not thinking about anything. You're in the wow, full stop in the wow mode. Neutral. You're in neutral. And then you may have a time where you're talking, brainstorming. We call this flipping the script. And say, yeah, well, what about this? What about this? And you're going back towards, you know, the wowness. You're going back to the wowness. You're making progress. So we can relate in one of these three ways with one another. This is the new relationship. We give ourselves the permission to sit still, to sit quietly, like this. This is the new relationship. This is the new relationship of the new dispensation. Which is the next stage in the ministry of Jesus here, but the ministry of the Holy Spirit, the ministry of the Spirit of Truth here, the ministry of the Spirit of Truth. Keep in mind that the body of Jesus was just like us. It's a stick figure, it's a puppet figure, and it's the mind that's animating these bodies entirely. It's the mind. So the mind of Jesus animated a body. The mind of Jesus is the Spirit of Truth. No arrogance. So just merely Spirit of Truth, just as we in reality are the Spirit of Truth too. There's only one Spirit of Truth, true for all, exactly the same for all, true for all. So you're hearing these things for the first time, and this is the beginning of getting used to it, saying, wow, yeah, we can relate that way. Now, those people who don't go along with the new dispensation, of course, they won't go along with this. They'll say, don't bother me. I heard what you said. Okay, you know. And they won't do it. They won't relate. They want to relate in the old way. They want to relate in the old way. But that doesn't get anywhere. That just, you're just spinning your wheels in mud. You're just jumping rope, but you're not actually getting with it. Getting with it. So one thing that people simply don't do, in my whole life, I've never ever had an instance where somebody just gave me the permission to be in neutral. Never. Nor have I ever had an instance where somebody actually engaged me in at the level of assertion. Asserting, let's assert, yeah, let's, hey, here's an assertion. Nobody's ever done that. Not even once. Other than those who comment here, but I'm talking about as you go about your life, meeting people, actually meeting people, you know, like in that way. It's never happened. Flipping the script, that did occur to some extent back in the 60s and early 70s. And that sort of died off. And since then, it really hasn't happened. I can't recall it happening since the 60s. It really... I had some instances where we were talking about and we're trying to flip the script, but we didn't understand the wow and the assertion part of it. There's a three parts to it. And so it just sort of didn't go anywhere. So that's an incredible indictment of this world. Absolute indictment. The world has just been spinning its wheels, just stuck in mud for my entire life here, almost 60 years. It's gone absolutely nowhere, stuck in the mud. And because of this, we're now experiencing this extraordinarily ill-conceived, ill-fitting ideological suit that we're supposed to be put on. It's really a straitjacket. We're being straitjacketed. All the while, the tailor, you know, is telling us, I have a wonderful suit for you. In fact, this is a special suit for you. And I put a lot of effort into design into this suit, and you're going to love it. And let me help you into this suit coat, you know, the sport coat here. It's just like, it's the newest design. It's a very wonderful, artfully designed design. So you're struggling to put this jacket on and say, this is a weird jacket. And I say, here, wait a minute, in order to get it on, you need to put your, you know, put the here and here, and before you know it, what are you doing? Oh, well, we need to buckle this up for stability and stuff. And then you say, then you try to move and you realize you're in a straight jacket. You've been put in a straight jacket and you can't get out. I mean, the buckles are in back of a straight jacket. You can't get out of a straight jacket. Terrible. And then they say, see, I told you you'd like it. Don't you love it? It's a wonderful suit of clothes. Aren't I a master tailor? Didn't I tell you truly? Meanwhile, you're stuck in the straitjacket. And you say, actually, you're an arch deceiver who shamelessly deceived me into getting into this straitjacket. You can say that. Or arrogance. Arrogance shamelessly scripted this, you know. Shamelessly scripted this. It's oftentimes, you know, the people involved in various, you know, situations, they don't seem to know, realize they're involved, but one mind knows, so we need to forgive ourselves at the level of mind, which is enmeshed in this arrogance, forgive the mind, so to speak, very windy here, it's breezy, very breezy. Forgive the mind. Cool, too. Very cool. California's in a cool spell. Very much a cool spell. Cloudy and cool every day. Just, I guess, as the rest of the nation heats up, California does the opposite and gets cool. And in the winter, when everyone's freezing, California is like summer here. So it's really cuckoo. Absolutely. It feels like winter now. And in winter, it felt like summer. We had 90, 95 degrees. You know, we were getting just... It's unbelievable how warm it was in times when it should be cold. So now we're in this very, very cool phase here. It's supposed to be like this for the next 10 days at least. I'd prefer for it to warm up, that is for sure. makes taping a lot easier, a lot more comfortable. So, out of the practice that we're doing, what's the most important? Full stop on the wow is most important. That is the most important part of the practice. We can practice assertions. There's a lot of people have been practicing assertions, new thought. Some of the new stuff that's going around the world now is a lot of assertions, and you know, so we can do that. And then we can also even brainstorm, talk spiritual shop, you know, shop talk. Okay, people can do that. But what I find nobody's doing really is full stop in the wow. This is where the rubber hits the road. This is the tough part. So getting started on doing that and actually proving to yourself that it smooths out your path and continue to do it, you'll never regret it. This is what is going to turn you into a bodhisattva, a savior. Absolutely it will. Absolutely this is what it will enable you to do. So it's this that we have to focus on. It is full stop in the wow. We must focus on, for those who want to get with this new dispensation, full stop in the wow is the key cornerstone of this. The key cornerstone. It is the cornerstone. Full stop in the wow. It is the key practice to focus on. And it's the one that people have the most resistance towards. They'll do anything but that because they think they're losing their momentum. They say, "No, I got to win. I'm in a race. I have momentum. I can't stop." But keep in mind, it's stopping and realizing that there is no finish line. There is no race. There is no contest. God's never been involved in any contest. There's no winner and loser. There's no perfection has always been here right now. That's the realization. And you don't have to take one step to realize that. As soon as you think you have to go somewhere to get it, you can't find it because it's right here. So stopping is very important. It is very important to get used to shifting into neutral like this, which gets us closer and closer and closer and closer to ultimately the realization that God's not involved in any race with us whatsoever. In other words, we see God as God truly is instead of an adversary that's in a race with us, in a contest with us, which is how we're really seeing God right now. How we're believing, misperceiving God as being in a contest, a race with us, and an adversary, actually. Now, we try to stay on friendly terms with God, not to anger God, because we think if we anger God, God's going to then run faster, you see? So we kind of want to like try to lull God into jogging. And so, yes, I pray to you, God. I'm doing all these wonderful things for you. You're so wonderful. And all this worship and stuff. We're really just trying to get God to slow down, thinking that this is a way for God to say, "Oh, they're not really trying to run too fast. I don't need to run too fast then, you know. We're just jogging along here." And all the while then we say a little prayer to God and then we try to run super fast. And then we say a little prayer to God. "Hey God, we love you so much. You're wonderful." And then run real fast. This is what we've been doing. This is what we've been doing. This is the way that we've been relating to God, is really trying to deceive God. We're hoping that our prayers somehow get God to slow down. By partially saying, "Hey God, I'm taking it easy. Why don't you take it easy too? I'm not trying to run too fast, God. You know, you don't need to run fast. I'm not running fast. Let's just take it easy here for a while." You know, and you know those kind of games you play as a kid. You play those games too, right? This is what we're about. If you think you're going to get beat, you try to slow your competitor down and say, "Hey, let's just be friends. Let's shake hands. You know, we're not really competing." And then just when you get them to drop their guard, suddenly you take off real fast. This is the kind of games we played as kids, you know. Say, okay. We'll say, "Okay, you know, you win." Or you say, "Okay, you win, God. You win. I know you're going to win." So, you know, flatter God. Say, "God, you're so wonderful. You're so great. You're such a winner." And then as soon as we think God is kind of like, saying, "Wow, yeah, you're right, I'm such a winner, this is wonderful," then suddenly, boom, we're off again really fast. It's exactly what we're doing. Exactly what we're doing. So it's the realization that there is no race at all. It's amazing how children's games we play as children are really showing so clearly what our arrogance is all about, and what we're really up to, what we're really up to. I mean, we say to God, "Hey, God, I'll tell you what. I'll let you win the race, if you just let me, at least have some period of time where I feel like I might be winning. You see, and you could just do that for me, God. And then if you just let me feel like I might be winning, then I'll be happy, and then I'll let you win the race." So, and we think God says, "Oh, okay, sure, that's fair. Sounds fair." I say, "Okay, God, you just sit right there. Don't you go anywhere." And then so I'm gonna just be running like this, but don't worry. I'm just trying to get this feeling like maybe I can win. And then once I get that feeling, then you can come on and win. Okay, so you just sit right there. So we get God to sit right there, and then we take off as fast as possible. And we say, "Not yet, God. I don't quite have the feeling yet. Not yet." You know. Meanwhile, we're desperately trying to reach the finish line. You know, it's all we're trying to deceive God. We're trying to trick God. You know, it's hilarious. This is what we have done throughout history. This is what we have done. This is what we've been up to. Or we say, hey, God, just stand right there. I won't move here. We'll both sit here together, stand here together." And then, of course, we're still walking, and then we say, "Well, I'm meditating, God. I'm not really walking, I'm meditating. Or I'm meditating while I walk, or I'm meditating while I run. So it's not really, I'm not really trying to win, God. I'm actually meditating while I'm running." And then we think that God says, okay, you know, okay, sure. This is our play in our mind, that we think we're outfoxing God. But the ultimate truth is God is not paying the slightest attention to any of this. There is no race at all. There's no contest at all. God is not paying the slightest attention to any of this. It's just, we're just having this imaginary race with God in our mind. Imaginary contest. And we use all sorts of stratagems, all sorts. We play the cripple. God, have mercy. I can't look. I'm so crippled. I can hardly go at all. You know, it's like it's not fair. You're so healthy, and I'm so crippled. You know, can you give me a break and let me, you know, can you slow down for me and stuff? And we just engage in every sort of, "I'm getting old, God. I'm getting so old. You know, how can I? It's not right. Look at me. You're still fresh and young, and I'm getting so old. Can you at least give me a break and maybe take a rest for a while, and let me at least get one last glimpse of faded glory here, God?" You know, so we're trying to do is get to that finish line first, thinking that if we don't, we'll be annihilated. So of course we're going to use every strategy we can possibly think of, and we have done just that. So what do we do now? What do we do? Full stop in the wow. You see, bringing this up is a huge wow. I've never seen this before. So clear. This for me, it's really tremendous. I realized in my childhood playing these games, I realized that's exactly what I was doing. My mind was starting to engage in this contest and trying to figure out tricky ways to win. And this is what we've all done. All of us have done this. So this is a tremendous wow. Stunning, stunning breakthrough. This notion of a race with God and how we're trying to trick God to go into going slower so that we can win. It's a wonderful way of looking at the situation, actually. So I know that backlash is going to come from this, you see? You can just count on it, right? When you have a breakthrough of this magnitude, you know there'll be backlash. So instead of the soldiering on and thinking, well, maybe it won't come this time. You say, no, it's 100% sure it's going to come. So I'm absolutely going to practice full stop on the wow. And even if I don't think it's 100%, I'm going to err on the side of probability here, that and still do full stop in the wow. Err on the side of caution. Err on the side of caution here. So we are going to practice this full stop in the wow, where we shift into this a more of a neutral state, where we're not trying to go forward or backwards on this, where we may even forget about what we just said, actually, and not even think, well, how did I get there, and try to retrace. Now, don't try to retrace your thoughts. Don't try to remember what the insight was. Focus on full stop in the wow. We're not really reacting on one way or the other here. This is a preemptive step. Preempts the backlash. Man, there's no question. I feel my nerves, my body are just humming with reaction. It's just very profound. So, okay, full stop in the wow. Not trying to figure anything out. Not trying to measure anything. Not trying to measure the intensity. Not trying to measure the progress. No yes, no no. You know, say, what progress? I'm not thinking of progress or no progress. Neither one. I know of neither. I don't know anything. Full stop in the wow. I don't know anything. I don't know anything, so don't know anything. Just no yes, no no, no no side tripping this way, side tripping that way. Not going forward, the past, no forward, no past, no side tripping. No up, no down. No forwards, no backwards. No up, no down. No side tripping. No naming, no labeling, no measuring, no scheming, no designing, no planning. No humming a song, thinking about something to say. No trying to go to sleep, no trying to take action. Just waiting patiently here. Neither forward or backwards. No yes, no no. No maybe. And we don't think, well, why am I, why did I stop? Why did I stop? We don't say that. We know we stopped for a very good reason. Don't doubt it. Once you're in the full stop in the wow, you know you did it for a good reason, to preempt the backlash from a great breakthrough. So you just stick with it. don't take action. Let's just sit still. Now, plenty of people will say, okay, I understand it. I understand what you're saying, but they don't practice it. This is something that Longchenpa wrote about, saying those who are aware of all these practices and have studied them and don't actually practice them are incredible fools. Because obviously he must have been very aware that this is something that many do, is they can tell you what all the practices are. So yeah, you have this one and this one and this one, but they never do them. And that's the heights of foolishness, or the depths of foolishness that ruin your path. It's the ones who actually practice that ultimately end up succeeding. And the others are still saying, well, I know about that practice. Yeah, I know about succeeding. I can explain it to you. Yeah, I can explain it all this. But they don't actually practice it. This is the trouble. So really, you might just take 15 minutes. There's no set time, but let's just, for example, arbitrarily say it would take 15 minutes for full stop on the wow. It'll change your life. Just those 15 minutes will change your life. Because once you acquire this talent, this skill, you can handle any breakthrough or insight. And then you get this great confidence that you can go fast because you're okay. You know how to stop the backlash. So then you go very fast and have great insight. Now, I always had trouble just sitting with like a blank mind, or just trying to be still. I never could do that. I couldn't put it into any context. Now, this has a context, and it's active. It's you're actively trying to stay poised in this neutral state and pushing off any attempts to pull you out of it. It's not like you're just trying to sit here like with a blank mind, or you're just sitting with a blank mind and just... It's not like that. It's not like you're trying to force stillness upon yourself or force quiet mind upon yourself, anything like that. It's not like that. You're poised in this neutral state of neither yes nor no, neither accomplishment nor failure, neither winning nor losing. No attempt to figure anything out. No attempt to measure success. No attempt to add upon it or subtract from it. So this is your mind has to be very alert and keen for this. It's like a fire break. It's like you're doing this controlled burn. Okay, controlled burn. So when the raging wildfire of the backlash from your great insight arrives, it can't get across the burn. It's already burned. It's a fire break. The reactions cannot leap across it. You've already leveled everything there. So those who are going to get with the new dispensation, it's easy. They'll be easily identify themselves because they're the ones who are actually practicing. Without actually practicing, you cannot go into the new dispensation. You cannot just keep spinning your wheels conceptually. Now, doing full stop on the wheel might be the most difficult thing you've ever done. You might just feel like what's really happening is your arrogance is realizing it's doomed. It's doomed. That's what's happening. And so you think you're doomed. You're not doomed. It's arrogance that's doomed. You're not your arrogance. Nobody is their arrogance. But definitely this dooms arrogance. So recognize that's great. You want arrogance to be doomed. Absolutely. So say, oh, good. Good, good, good. I'm going to practice this. You're not trying to just eyes closed at the traditional type of way of, okay, I'm just gonna breathe, eyes closed, I'm trying to do a meditation. No, it's not quite like that. Although there's uniqueness. I think everyone's going to apply a certain different way to do this, actually, being given the uniqueness that arrogance has spun. This massive logic of arrogance has spun so much script that we all have a certain uniqueness. So everyone will have a certain, somewhat unique way to do it. But certainly you do have to, I don't know, it seems as though you do have to remain very vigilant, because you can easily drift out of this full stop state. So meditation is not easy. I mean, full stopping is not easy. It's not a matter of just being passive. It's not a matter of being passive, no. It's not just practicing passivity. Our submissiveness, passivity. I'm not really going to work too hard. No, you're fired up. You are reverberating with freedom, and you have to be very careful not to allow that to push you one way or the other. You're standing your ground, neither advancing nor retreating. And you're under tremendous pressure. So it's very serious business to engage in this. And take it as that. It's very serious. It's take it like your life is at stake, your existence, your destiny is at stake, everything's at stake. It's very serious to hold this yet neither yes nor no, hold this neutral state, hold this full stopness. Be very determined. Now, because of the uniqueness, you know, people have a tendency to, everyone has the same tendency to ask questions. Well, is this right? Is this right? Is this right? And what can you say? What can you say to that? What can anyone say? You have to be able to tune into your own intensity and know and feel that you're full stopping yourself and you're neither advancing nor retreating. However you do it, you have to be able to recognize that you're doing it. So you have to put the effort in. Don't just try something, say, hey, let me script it like this, and then ask, oh, is this, you think this is right? Is this right? No, you've got to be so determined that you just do it. It's like you've been underwater for a long time. You're desperate for breath. You don't come up to the surface and look around. Look, your lungs are bursting. You just feel like they're going to burst, and you feel you're going to pass out, and you finally get to break the surface and get your head above water. You don't look around and for permission, like, am I above the water? Can I breathe? No, you don't do it that way. As soon as you get above the water, you know, you're taking your air immediately, right? It's like that. This is the urgency of it. Look, so imagine that you're in a situation where you've dove down into the water, deep water, and you've been down there for a long time, and something's been holding you down. You got stuck down there. Now you're frantically swimming towards the surface of the water, and you don't have any more oxygen. You've used up every bit, and you're feeling all this carbon monoxide building up in you. Actually, of course, breathing it out gradually is good, so the carbon monoxide doesn't get to you, but you've breathed all the air out. You have nothing left in your lungs, and you're just like you're burning. And you finally get your mouth and nose above water and your head's above, breaks the surface. What do you do then? You don't ask questions. You'll say, is this it? Am I doing it right? You take a breath of air. You fill your lungs with air. You don't sit around asking anybody for permission or anything like that. So when you feel the wow, you realize that this is the road to salvation. This is the road to liberation. And you are going to guard that progress with your total determination, just like getting a breath of air after you've been almost passed out from no air. And you're going to guard that from any backlash. And so you're going to just stop in the wow, in the now, in a full stop right now. And you're not going to go forward or backwards. You're absolutely going to hold your ground with utmost determination. As if you were pulling in a breath to save yourself from passing out. So it's this level of determination that's required. Otherwise, you would just waste your time in asking questions and playing with it and not really being, you don't get anywhere that way. You have to be extremely determined. You're saying, I am not going to suffer anymore from backlashes. Absolutely not. I'm not going to allow it. I am not going to jeopardize my progress by allowing backlash to happen. And if I have to sit here for a half an hour intensely being neutral, then that's what I'm going to do. I am absolutely determined. So this is what it takes. But we all can have that intensity, absolutely. And if you don't have it, that means you don't want it badly enough. Is trying to catch a bird out front here, and the cat suddenly made a frantic effort to catch the bird, and the bird fluttered out of its way, and the cat's all unwound and upset about it. Be like the bird, that bird, and we're being stalked by a cat, and when the cat tries after us, we just flutter out of the way. We don't allow ourselves to get trapped by these attempts to snare us. Okay, we stay in this neutral mode. So again, this practicing full stop in the wow is the most important practice aspect. It is the key to this new dispensation, in the ministry of Jesus, in the ministry of the Spirit of Truth, in the ministry of the grace of God, in the ministry of the Holy Spirit. At some point, all this will smooth out to the realization, oh, there isn't any race. There isn't any finish line. There isn't any race. God's not trying to sneak up on me or catch up with me or pass me. God's not trying to sneak up on me at all. This was all just a dream that I had. There isn't any race. There's no contest. There's nothing to be determined. There's no outcome to be determined at all. Eventually, this will just smooth, and it will just smoothly transition into this awakened state, enlightened state. Absolutely, this is what we're working on. So look at it as a make or break practice. It's a key practice. It's a make or break practice. Just one practice you have to get proficient at. Just one. That's it. This full stop in the wow. That's all, the only practice you really need to be proficient at. The other stuff is actually easy, right? This is just the one practice you have to be good at. If you can't do this, then you're not going to succeed, in my opinion. You're not going to. So it's a make or break practice, but it's only one practice, right? So how can you fail? Don't let your mind start going into storytelling, scripting. Just stay neutral. Keep vigilantly watching your mind. Vigilantly watching your mind. Don't allow anything to pull it this way or that. Don't be imagining any scenario. Now, how long do you do it? Well, you know, theoretically, you could go on for hours like this, and it'd probably be very beneficial. But, you know, after I would say at least, you know, well, I can't even put a number on it. Depends how intense the wow is. Some wow is so intense that, but it takes a while. But at least you take the edge off of it. At least you can take the edge off of the backlash for sure. Blunt the edge. You know, once you really blunt the edge of something, it's not as sharp, right? Not gonna slice you up like a sharp knife, very, very blunt knife. No, it's not going to. So you've blunted the backlash. And again, be careful that don't try to send your mind back to remember what is it that caused this wowness. Don't think of it. This is key. Don't think of it. Later on, you'll be able to revisit it. What's important is not remembering what you did, but that your momentum is continued. Your progress and momentum is still there. So if you do it right, whatever you look at next, you'll actually go farther. You'll actually go farther. Let's say you're doing a massive hike in like Yosemite up to the top of a half dome or something, and you along the way you're getting close, and you're, there's some vistas, a lot of vistas, and you come across a vista and you're just like, wow, it's just mind. What do? Well, right away you say, okay, wow, and then you back off away so you don't. Back off the trail a bit, so you don't see the vista at all. You just see the trail, the trees, the trail, and you're not seeing the vista. And then just sit down there, and just sit there, still for a while. Just sit there for 10, 15, 20 minutes. And then what you're doing is you're allowing all the shock waves to subside. You're allowing all the shock waves to subside. Now, of course, there always, arrogance will always tell us that you're smart enough to be able to deal with this conceptually and just keep going. You know, it's stupid. Why only the stupid people stop? You're smart enough. This is always the trouble of arrogance, guaranteed. Okay, I can guarantee this to you. This is the trap that arrogance sets for us. See, I always thought that smartness had to do with effectiveness, right? And full stop on the wow is effective. So by you doing this, you're being maxing out your smartness. You're maxing it out. Because you're maxing out your effectiveness. Now, if you're determined as you climb up this trail with all these vistas to always back off and take a full stop in the wow once you come across an incredible vista, you will find when you get to the ultimate vista at the top, you can back away off that too. You get there and you know this is the ultimate vista, then you don't even look. You don't even look at that point. You say, okay, I know if I go a few more steps, I'm going to get this ultimate vista, but I'm not going to do it. I'm just going to sit down right here and do a full stop in the wow. And then, and only then, you finally get up and you say, wow, I'm ready for this. And you look out and you're calm. You're calm. And then you may take a good look and you say, okay, I'm going to back off again and full stop in the wow. I'm going to do again. And then you take another look like this and even more calm, back off again and do that and continue to do that. And after a while, you're able just to sit there with this vista and just say, oh, this is normal to me. This is my spaciousness. Whereas the others that didn't do this, they'll get up to the top of the vista point, and they'll look out and they'll go, oh, wow, and get so excited. And then before you know it, they're off down the trail, going somewhere else, back country, you know, and just like, see, they cannot sustain it. They cannot sustain it. Cannot sustain it. We're only interested in sustaining it. This is the new dispensation. The new dispensation is only interested in sustaining the vision of oneness, in sustaining it, in sustaining the experience of pure spaciousness, in sustaining this. That's all that it's interested in. This is the new dispensation. It's no longer just catching a glimpse, it's sustaining it. So our approach is different than the ones who only want to catch a glimpse and then they think they're really cool and they go say, oh my gosh, I got to run down and tell my friends and take a few pictures and run. Oh, did you know I went up to the top? Oh, really? Did you? That's great. Yeah, it was so neat up there. It's like, wow, you can't believe the view. And oh yeah, that's great. And then they're off to dinner and all this other stuff. Whereas you're still up there, you know, watching the sunset there. Watching the stars arise over this massive valley and spaciousness. Watching the dawn come You know, you're just sitting there quietly experiencing all of this, you see, sustaining it. So we're interested in sustaining. This is the new dispensation. So I still haven't gone back and remembered what it is that gave rise to this. Wow, it's not important. This is the amazing. You'll see your mind trying to go back again and again and again. And say, well, if I could just, you know, thinking you can make progress if you go back and remember what it is. Say, I'm ready to make progress. No, don't go back. Don't go back. Don't go back. We know we had a vista. We know we had a vista. So, but we're going toward the ultimate vista. So, you know, we don't need to try and remember what that vista was like. Just right now, we're just calming down. Oh, it's nice to have the heat of the sun on me a little bit, direct sunlight. Because the air is very cool. From all the fog, dense marine layer is parked off the coast of California here. It's just, it comes in the night and clouds everything over and hardly dissipates during the day. Who knows, it might be a cool summer. We've had summers here where every day was cool like this. It's not good for the tomatoes, that's for sure, but who cares about that this year? Who's growing tomatoes right now? I mean, people are tearing out their lawns. I mean, as we say, brown is the new green. I actually coined that phrase a while ago, and now it's in the paper. Brown is the new green. So, brown is the new green. Golf courses are tearing out their lawn in any area that's not essential. People are tearing out their front lawns. Some people are. Brown is the new green. There must be some way to make the brown look really nice and brown. Maybe I'm going to look into that, actually. That would be kind of cool to do that. And just play with shades of brown. Yeah, could do that. And again, full stop in the wow. Don't get carried away with activities, thinking about activities like that. It's easy then to start thinking about, okay, now how could I do this? Just say, okay, just go back into full stop in the wow. As we sort of come out of full stop in the wow, we get ready to sort of re-engage with our life, but do it gradually and slowly. Don't suddenly grab a hold of some project and start going after it as hard as you can. This is a problem. You stay kind of non-committal. Okay, so it seems as though the wow is sort of dissipating now, and I'm feeling, you know, pretty normal again. So again, the advice is do not try and engage in any sort of vigorous project at all at this point, nor even think about one, because that's still. That's like seeing a view and then saying, "Oh my gosh, I got to go tell everybody about it." You don't want to do that. Let these projects that come up, that say, okay, maybe I'll do that at some point, but I'm not going to think about it right now. Do not allow ambition to grab a hold of you. Because remember, our trouble is trying to win. Believing that if we don't, we're going to lose everything. Be annihilated. So practice, 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 practice. I've really been practicing this my whole life, constantly trying to come across some spiritual teachings that produce a wow in me, and then trying to cope with it somehow. And I've realized that the use of your will is the best way to cope with it, to insist that you stop and go into neutral, and then hold yourself there. If you were in a sailboat, you would, you know, there's a wind. Instead of sailing downwind, nice and easy, just going downwind or tacking upwind, you just sort of keep yourself going sideways to the wind. You don't go either up, tack upwind or sail downwind. Neither one. Neither one. So once again, the key, this is the key to the new dispensation, to be able to abide in realization and non-dual abidance, to abide there, instead of just glimpse it, to abide there. This is our goal. The goal, the way of getting there, is spend a lot of time in full stop in the wow, spend time in flipping the script, assertions, and getting to the wow, and then spend time in the wow. Now it may seem like those who don't do that, who are continue on flipping the script, keep going, like they're the ones who are going fast, they're the ones who are going to succeed. It is not true. Those are the ones who are going to fail. Which is why I say don't use stimulants in this new dispensation. Don't use stimulants. Because if you do, you will just push right past the wow and keep going instead of stopping. And you have to be in touch, like, when do you stop? When do you go into the full stop in the wow? You have to be aware of how you're feeling, the intensity, and you have to be aware of it. And at some point, you'll just feel like, wow, I'm just, like, shaking. The intensity is just tremendous. And then you realize, wow, I'm really in this tremendous, severely wow reaction. And then you know that's time to then go into the full stop in the wow. Be proactive. Be proactive with this. Whereas if you're jacked up on stimulants, you don't know. You're just guessing. You say, well, maybe I can stop now, but I don't really know. I could go for longer. You don't have the sensitivity or awareness of how to play the situation at all. The sun is dipping down now, and it's going to start cooling off here. So, how are we doing on the video here? We've reached pretty good, right? 145 or so. What was the? Oh yeah, the graphic. Let me see. Can we go to a graphic here? The Jesus of the new dispensation. Can we go to this graphic? Yeah, let me see if it's going to pop up or not. Oh yeah, there you go. This is very wowish, huh? The Jesus of the new dispensation. Full stop in the wow, by abiding in the vision of oneness here. This is just scintillating with radiating, isn't it? Intensity. Absolutely radiating intensity. And yet you can see that Jesus is easily, is just in it, just abiding in it here. Just abiding. This is abidance. Now, have all sorts of different people and groups and etc. around the world been aiming towards this? Absolutely. Yes. There have been a lot of people meditating and in one way or the other trying to minimize the backlash. We're just becoming more and more conscious of it. Here, it's very clearly explained. We're very conscious and aware of it and practicing it very directly here. And we have a context here. So, we're going to be able to abide in the non-dual oneness. We'll be able to ultimately handle that. We absolutely will. It's sort of a helpful graphic if you see the intensity of just abidance, you know, nothing has changed. The expression is just a pure abidance here. Very intense abidance. Okay. Very great. We're going to wrap it up for now, and I'm going to get inside before I get too cold. And we'll keep on. Don't jump into anything.